gave any thought to the term depression was just a few years ago when I watched a commercial advertising Cymbalta. At the time, it all seemed so trivial to me, the rainy weather, the sad music. My naive self passed off depression as just another health condition from which only middle-aged people suffered, one that could be miraculously treated by some obscure prescription medication. It wasn't until I felt the symptoms firsthand that I really began to give it some thought. Over the course of my junior year, I often hear people ask, "Brianna, are you okay?" Well, no, I wasn't, but this unspoken rule prohibited me from saying so. I mean, whoever responds with a no, right? When I look back at my experiences, I find it appalling that such prevalent condition was so foreign to me. And because I knew so little about it, I couldn't help but stigmatize it. By my standards, I was lazy, weak, not trying hard enough, selfish. The last thing I wanted to do was speak up. I didn't want others to perceive me the same way. See, depression is the elephant in the room. It's the subject people least want to talk about. And when they do, it's done behind closed doors and in hushed voices because people are afraid of speaking up. They're afraid that admitting how they feel will make them appear weak. Just think of the word itself, depression. We can define it in so many different ways and can use it in so many different contexts. Depression can be anything from the feeling you get when you fail a test to the feeling you get when you aren't able to get out of bed for 2 days. Everyone has different reactions to different situations, but where do we draw the line to distinguish depression from a fleeting moment of despair? In most cases, it's hard to draw the line. Take UFC fighter Ronda Rousey, for example. A few weeks ago, Rousey appeared on The Ellen Show and spoke out about her suicidal thoughts following her loss to Holly Holm. As expected, her remarks were met with backlash from a community of people who don't seem to grasp the concept of mental illness. These are just a couple of the many negative thoughts aimed toward Rousey. For the most part, people seem to accept depression as a prevalent condition, yet don't seem to buy the fact that her loss could lead to suicidal thoughts. Without even realizing it, they are stigmatizing depression, calling her weak and pathetic for having these thoughts over a loss. Many said she deserved it because she was arrogant and needed to be humbled. Well, I'm not here to refute claims of her arrogance or convince you that she's humble. What I will say is that Rousey does not need to justify herself for having suicidal thoughts. Consider this. Rousey has devoted her entire life to her profession, one that she values more than anyone. She is under constant public scrutiny, her every action and every word criticized to some extent. What most people don't know is that both her father and grandfather took their own lives. There's a saying that pain is relative, that not one person feels pain the same way as another. Before we make these comments on the subject of mental illness, we must first try to empathize. Consider what it might be like to be that person, and try to take a different approach. One of the greatest reasons why the stigma exists in the first place is because we fail to recognize depression as an actual illness. Read these comics. Have you tried, you know, not having the flu? Well, lying in bed obviously isn't helping you. You need to try something else. Would you approach a physical illness the same way you would approach a mental one? Some might refute that the two aren't comparable because one can be controlled and the other cannot. Of course, this isn't true, and the two are more alike than you may think. Today, there are 5 illnesses considered by health insurance companies to be preventable and therefore uninsurable: cardiovascular disease, high blood pressure, asthma, diabetes, and depression. Of the 30 or so percent of people who do seek professional help for their depression, not all can afford it because it isn't covered by their insurance. Those who refuse to seek help altogether do so for fear of being chastised by coworkers, family members, friends, even mental health practitioners themselves. They are under the pretense that they will not be accepted for who they are, that they will be discriminated against. It is this discrimination, this lack of empathy, this lack of basic knowledge of what depression is that has resulted in recent $26 billion cuts in treatment spending, funding that could save many lives. To this day, depression in teens is passed off as a normal part of growing up, that it may not even exist at all. Oftentimes, adults don't recognize the mood swings and irritability and isolation from loved ones as depression, but rather an act of rebellion on the teenager's part. Granted, it is difficult to make sense of a teenager's roller coaster of emotions, but not all behavior can be attributed to hormones. Every year, nearly 5,000 people between the ages of 15 to 24 take their own lives due to their depression. That makes suicide the third leading cause of death amongst high schoolers and the second leading cause of death amongst college-aged youth. During one of the most pivotal points in their lives, a time where they should be discovering who they are and developing their self-esteem and independence, teens are fighting an internal battle that not even they can understand, one that has been passed off by the adults around them as mere teenage angst. Depression is universal, and it is real. It has no religion, no race, no gender or socioeconomic status. Before I came and spoke on this topic, I was absolutely terrified, not only because it's nerve-wracking to speak in front of so many people, but also because I knew I had to confront an issue that I had kept hidden from family members and friends for so long. Well, now that I've spoken up, I encourage all of you to do the same. Thank you.